I remember in one of my women's studies courses, we were talking about what makes a feminist a feminist. And one woman said that as long as you have experienced oppression and you have an understanding or a consciousness of justice and injustice, then you can become a feminist through that lens. And I disagree. I think it's more than that. What makes a feminist, or an intactivist, is taking your consciousness and applying it with an activist component. That part of this work is being an activist. And in terms of my intactivism, I'm rather new. I've only been doing this for about 2 years, but I've done a considerable amount in those 2 years. There's a point when you have this experience and you need to survive it for your own psychological health, but part of that for me is utilizing it in a form of activism to help other people, because my experiences are not they're not unique to me. So in terms of intactivism, it's been important through the last 2 years to read as much medical literature as possible, and to really engage in an intactivist method of work. For my undergraduate degree, I am pursuing a bachelor's in women's studies, and I came to women's studies through my experiences with Rape Crisis Center, which is grounded in my sexual assaults. And before I got to women's studies as a discipline, I became very interested in feminism and feminist theory. In high school, I needed something that would offer me a way to really articulate what was going on. It was one thing to survive the experiences, to transition from a victim to a survivor, but I needed something that would articulate what was exactly going on here, looking at it from a larger framework. And I remember reading bell hooks in one of her novels, I believe, Teaching to Transgress. She talks about that she came to feminism in need. She came to theory in need. And that theory is a way to understand the world within and around us. And I really liked that. That feminism as a movement, but also as theories, are there to understand our experiences, to articulate them in the process of trying to better our living conditions. I often refer to myself as a feminist intactivist. I do not remove feminism from intactivism because it's the groundwork that from which everything else is situated. So my intactivism is grounded in feminism and feminist theory, and with an importance of social justice, a consciousness of these issues. Most of what I do is in that realm, in that discipline, also sociology, but I don't do a lot of demonstrations. I don't feel comfortable doing demonstrations, although I don't trivialize them. They're important, but I tend to kind of stay in the academic sector, although lately I've been getting into Facebook, and I always scoffed at Facebook thinking that, oh, that's a waste of time, but that has actually been a godsend for feminism, because I've met so many people across the world or been connected to them via Facebook. And so when I present at conferences, like I just finished presenting in Lisbon, Portugal, about the history of the intactivist movement, a little survey about it. Some of the people who are in Europe knew about my speech and were be able to discuss that. It was a nice way of connecting with people, good networking. And today, in fact, I finished presenting at the Medicalization of Sex Conference at Simon Fraser University in Vancouver, Canada. And so it was really nice because there were several people who really were engaged in the presentation, and they wanted the information. They were really interested. If you are a marginalized group within the marginalized, it becomes exceedingly difficult to try to show or gain visibility in your own movement. I never thought that it was weird to be a man and be a feminist. Everyone around me did, but I always thought that women or that feminism challenges the dualism of gender. It challenges gender binaries and these rigid roles between males and females, or even the categories themselves of male and female. So I never thought that it's problematic to be a male feminist. But, in the 60s, one of the limitations was that the idea of a man being a feminist was just unheard of. It just didn't make sense to a lot of women that how could a man be a feminist? And we as the movement, feminism, have really grown from that. I think in lots of the Feminist Majority Foundation or the National Organization for Women, you have these feminist allies who are men, and you have men who identify as feminists. So I think we've really grown from that limitation. And in terms of male circumcision, obviously, in feminism, we talk about female circumcision. It's a violence against women, and it's a reproductive rights issue. Male circumcision is no different. We as feminists are concerned with inflicting some kind of gendered violence or violence in general against someone without consent. Doesn't matter if it's male or female. Both of these surgeries are being inflicted upon children who cannot consent. Many of them, the majority of them, are medically unnecessary, and they have a litany of problems associated, and ethical dilemmas, of course. And so I think that a current limitation of feminism is that it does not incorporate male circumcision or the concept of genital autonomy as an inalienable right across the gender continuum. It only focuses on genital autonomy as it relates to females. At times, I will feel a bit betrayed, but that doesn't mean that I'm going to give up on feminism. Feminism is very important to me in my life and my experiences, and also for a lot of other people. It's a movement that ends sexism and sexist exploitation wherever it manifests, and I use that definition by bell hooks. And I like bell hooks' definition because it names the problem of sexism. The problem is sexism, rather, not men. And it doesn't matter who's perpetuating sexism, regardless if it's male, female, or an intersexed person. So I think that one of the limitations currently is that genital autonomy is not conceptualized as an issue that is relevant to males or the intersexed. But I think that my contribution to both feminism and the genital autonomy or the intactivist movement is to do what I can to bridge the movements, which is very difficult. And I have certainly made people uncomfortable in the process, but most of the time people are very receptive to what I have to offer because they know how important feminism is. I don't have to, argue that I'm a feminist. They don't think I'm disguising as one just to promote intactivism.